In the first part of this week's lab, you're going to become familiar with the water cycle. The water cycle, like any other cycle in the Earth system, describes the movement of material between the different spheres of the Earth system. Those spheres are things like the atmosphere, the biosphere, the hydrosphere, the lithosphere, and so forth. Any Earth system cycle involves what are known as reservoirs. These are places where the material is found, and processes that move the material between different reservoirs. Those processes are called fluxes. A flux has units of volume over time. The reservoirs themselves have units of volume. This is the figure from the lab showing the water cycle. To that, I've added the size of the reservoirs, volumes in cubic kilometers, and also the magnitude or size of the fluxes in units of cubic kilometers per year. You should also label the reservoirs and fluxes with their values before you proceed. Now that we have our water cycle figure labeled, I've added the numbers to it. Let's think about what we can learn about the water cycle from studying this figure. Well, we've got our reservoirs, places like the atmosphere, the oceans, groundwater, and so forth. And we also have processes like precipitation, like evaporation, and so forth. Those processes are broken down depending on what reservoir they're moving water in between. For example, we have evaporation from the ocean to the atmosphere. We have evaporation from the continents and biosphere to the atmosphere, and so forth. Now, if these reservoirs, if the volume of water in these reservoirs is going to remain constant, the size of the fluxes going into the reservoir need to be balanced by the size of the fluxes going out of the reservoir. For example, if the volume of water in the atmosphere is going to remain constant, then the total evaporation into the atmosphere, here and here, needs to be equal to the total volume or total amount of water being precipitated out of the atmosphere. In other words, these numbers should add together to equal those two numbers. In other words, the total flux in to the reservoir should equal the total flux out. So in the first three questions, show that that's the case for the ocean reservoir, for the atmosphere reservoir, and for the groundwater reservoir. Show that the fluxes going into it add together to equal the total fluxes going out of the reservoir added together. We can also think about the water cycle in terms of residence times. The average amount of time water remains in a given reservoir. The residence time equals the volume of that reservoir divided by the total or the fluxes in or out of that reservoir, but not both. You can add up the total fluxes in, or you can add up the total fluxes out. And you're dividing the volume by that number. Why does this give a residence time? Well, a time is going to have units of years, or days, or month, or any other unit of time. What we're doing is we have the volume, in this case it's in cubic kilometers. We're dividing by fluxes, which are in units of cubic kilometers per year. By dividing volume by flux, our cubic kilometers are canceling. We're left with units of time, year, which will be an appropriate unit for a residence time. So for example, to find residence time of water in the atmosphere, take the volume of water in the atmosphere, divided by the total fluxes either out of the atmosphere, in other words, the total of those two numbers, or the total flux into the atmosphere, the sum of those two numbers. You could do it either way, and you should get the same answer.